So I'd love just for you guys to do a quick intro and tell me about yourselves you know, the organization that you're at and kind of the division within the organization that you're at, just to start it off.
Sure. Yeah, thanks for having me. Dustin Moser, digital lead at TaxAct, so lead digital marketing. If you haven't heard of TaxAct, we are online tax software provider, so TurboTax and H&R Block are our direct competitors. And I lead a team of channel marketers as well as a team that manages our marketing technology stack.
Hey guys, thanks for having me as well. Nathan Dinh, I come from Uber. Lead digital growth for driver growth at Uber. Essentially under our team, we manage programmatic DSPs, ad tech, and everything like that. About the company Uber, we're a ride-sharing platform. We connect riders and drivers, eaters. I don't know if you guys have heard of us. If you want a promo code, I can provide. Yeah, awesome. Before that, I was at AppAnnie, which is a mobile data analytics company. I was leading their B2C growth, and then gaming before that. Yeah, mobile gaming.
Cool. So, so I just talked a lot about in-housing solutions, and I'd love to understand kind of what this means for you guys and your companies and your specific divisions. So what does in-house mean to you?
Yeah, for us, in-housing has been a multi-year initiative for us. And for us, it's really about taking control of the data, having access to that data, having transparency with our partners, and really owning the tech stack, anything from, you know, DCM, Tag Manager, Google Analytics, even on the email side, owning the ESP, and, you know, even now having DMP conversations, kind of our next step into the tech stack as well. But as we, you know, embarked on this initiative several years back, it really came down to, you know, we're a smaller player in the tax industry, and that enables us to be very nimble. And we wanted to make sure we had that nimbleness, whether it was the agencies we worked with or working in-house. So to do that, we thought we actually would have a competitive advantage by continuing to port more of that in-house. So the one thing we kept hearing from the agencies that we did work with was, you know, your competitors take a week to turn around decisions, and you guys can do that on the fly in a given hour. So by starting to port more of that data in-house, get it at our fingertips, enabled us to be even quicker. And going back to that nimbleness, you know, really if we can work quicker and harder, you know, we have much smaller budgets than a TurboTax and H&R Block, so it enables us to make our dollars work harder, be more competitive in the landscape.
Yeah, for Uber, we weren't always in-house. So it's been actually a long journey for us. So about 3-4 years ago, we saw, you know, meteoric rise, right? So we did enlist an agency at that time to do a lot of our global buying. This was, in fact, in part, we couldn't hire as aggressively internally. So we enlisted an agency to manage our buys. And as you can imagine, our global budgets were, you know, close to $500 million a year. So we needed to just push this, and we needed to grow fast. But in the last couple of years, we realized, you know, on top of really bringing the data in-house, we needed to get closer to the buying. Everything from fraud to transparency and things like that. We didn't feel that these agencies were the proper stewards of our budget and can really own the KPIs and the things that we needed to report back out on. And so we really just analyzed how much we were paying in terms of fees, how much we were paying in terms of all sending out our data and things like that. And just our core advantage is our data, and given the ride-sharing space and how competitive it is, we can't really prevent a lot of these agencies from learning from us and then turning around and working with a lot of our competitors. So we had to make that strategic decision to bring it in-house. So over the last 2 years, we've been hiring aggressively in-house. For us, in-house means hiring like a specific channel manager, so social, affiliates, programmatic, and I know a lot of teams do it very similarly. And then from there, they own the strategy, and then they own the deployment as well.
Yeah, so I'd love to understand, and maybe from TaxAct, but from both of you, like, how are your organizations organized, right? So you're saying it's kind of based on channel. How are you guys doing it? What do those teams look like? Because I think for a lot of the group who may be interested in this, we're really trying to figure out what is the ideal setup for going in-house. So maybe just some information about how you guys are set up today, how you're organizing, and you know, are you trying to update that further and grow further?
Yeah. For us, we're set up very similar. So we do have dedicated channel owners. So I manage a team of really only 7 folks that are dedicated to a specific channel, from display, social, affiliate, SEO, and the list keeps going. But you know, for them, they really do own that strategy, just like Nathan is saying. And they, you know, if their channel is in-house, they are building that strategy, you know, closely with me and others on the team. And they are going straight from strategy to execution and optimization. A lot of times they're doing their own reporting and feeding that back in to make those obviously optimizations and shift budgets around between tactics. Outside of the channel owner's responsibilities, we also have a marketing analyst dedicated to the team. That was one of our probably biggest pain points, I would say, as we brought in-house is, we now have this wealth of data, what do we do with it, right? I mean, that was our goal, but it can almost be overwhelming, you know, when you have it at your fingertips. And the dedicated channel owners can only do so much as far as digging into the data on a day-by-day basis. So I would say that's been the key addition lately, is making sure we have the right BI resources to help support our channel owners and make sure they're successful. And then just from a marketing technology stack, we kind of have one of our channel leads, happens to be our display channel lead, that he kind of owns the overall marketing stack as well. So he has a nice balance of that analytical mindset as well as the tech knowledge as well. But it's nice to have kind of one kind of centralized owner of our now centralized stack as well, that he can be the go-to resource for folks to go to. And as they traffic their tags and they do the reporting, that if they're having any issues or questions just about how all the channels are weaving together within the data, the tech stack, he's kind of the go-to on that.
Do you see, and maybe this question's for both of you, and I'm just going to try to talk loud. So do you see now that there's actually more that you're able to do across channels? So, you know, a lot of these things tend to get very siloed when you might be working with an agency who has different divisions for each of the different channels. Are you seeing that your messaging and your kind of customer journeys are starting to come together more? Like, how is that working for you know, either of you?
Yeah, so at Uber, when we brought things in-house, we broke things up into 3 parts. We had rider, eats, and driver. And for each division, we hired a brand new marketing team. So as you can imagine, Uber, we just go all out in everything we do. And we kind of probably, I would say, a little overhired a little bit. But I think right now, so we have, similar to what you guys are doing, we have a programmatic team, a search team, a display team, an affiliate team. And then we have an ad tech team and a data science team that supports all of that. And then sitting above that is a cross-channel and strategy team. So back to your question, we do have a more cohesive message and we can move in a more agile manner, versus in the past, we would have to communicate everything through to the agency. We'd have to go through the chain of command and then also, and then things will get done. But at Uber, it can be much more agile now. I would say it's still a little slow now, but I mean, we can definitely move more agile at bringing it in-house.
All right. Yeah. All right. And where are you guys with the process? Are you still leveraging agencies or external partners? Have you kind of cut that off holistically, and or do you plan to? Where does that sit with the partner and agency involvement?
Yeah, on our side, we have had search in-house for about 5 years now. So it was actually, we reached the decision point years back where we were actually working with advertising.com back in the day, and they dropped the search offering.
Right.
So we had to make a kind of quick decision on the spot, like, are we ready to move it in-house, or do we go another agency? And at the time we said, okay, let's do it. We were in the off season, it was just after tax season, so we, you know, went out, found the right bidding tool that we wanted to go with. We ended up finding more of a consultant or almost mentor relationship with someone that had worked on our account in the past, and helped kind of transition that in-house for us. So we were kind of off and running after, I would say, about 9 months of making the decision. The only other channel that, our only channel we leverage agencies really for today is still display. And we're kind of straddling that line. So we manage 3 DSPs, but our display channel owner is kind of in the weeds with those guys, handles all the trafficking of tags. He's doing the creative testing, landing page testing yet. But as far as actually pulling the levers from a day-to-day optimization and adjusting from a tactical perspective, the agency is still doing that for us. But constant communication, kind of.
Why is that? Like, what's the decisioning there on why you kind of kept that partner mix?
Yeah, it's been, I'd say more of a resource thing for us. We haven't been quite ready to jump into the FTEs to staff up for display. It's certainly on the radar, but I would also say over the last 2 years, we've really negotiated our agreements with our three agency partners to have really transparency, you know, in the rates. So we do know what we're spending on, you know, tech versus third party, you know, fees and what's actually going to media. So that's given us a comfort level. We're constantly doing that ROI assessment to say, you know, there's still a little meat left on the bone, but we're pretty comfortable with where we are. It's not where, you know, a significant pain point for us, but it's definitely the end goal to get display in-house over the next probably 12 to 18 months would be the end goal.
I definitely believe agencies are definitely a part of our buying model. After 2017, as you guys can imagine, Uber went through probably one of the hardest years any company has gone through. And previously that, we've been hiring primarily acquisition managers, so very lower funnel managers. We didn't have any issue of awareness or consideration. People were coming to Uber in droves. So all we needed to do was target them correctly, get the ad in front of them, and capture them in that intent capture. But for 2017, we really had to pivot strategies. We had to really understand why users were not using Uber anymore. Why were they fleeing Uber? Why weren't they not considering us anymore and things like that? So as you guys know, we enlisted, we retained an agency for our strategy and our digital buying. I think using agencies in that way where they bring the knowledge and the brand chops per se to really help our company pivot quickly. We didn't have a lot of time. We needed to really figure out what was going on. We had a new CEO. So enlisting agencies in a very fast-moving way to bring the knowledge was extremely, extremely beneficial. And then also, back to what you're saying, we do use agencies as an extension of our team in terms of digital buying as well. We do use Jellyfish. Shout out to Jellyfish. We do use Jellyfish, you know, kind of like you in terms of justifying FTEs. As budgets, as campaigns continue to aggressively roll out, we can leverage teams like Jellyfish to staff up and support our team. And then obviously if things change, you know, we will adjust as accordingly, but we see that the partnership has been really strong and powerful.
Yeah, and it doesn't have to be necessarily a black and white, you know, decision either. So, you know, to your point about staffing up, and we definitely look at agencies as a way to just augment resources across the board. So also a Jellyfish partner, and they have been, you know, great. I'll ping Kylie in the back, you know, on almost a weekly basis of different scenarios of, hey, if we needed, you know, X, what would that look like within the organization? So it doesn't have to be even, you know, a long-term engagement. It could be something where we could augment with an agency for, you know, 3 months, 6 months, just to make sure that we're staffing up, especially with our seasonal business. I forgot where else I was going with that. But yeah, I mean, it's more of, you know, for us, it's really making sure that we're ready to augment. So even if we think we might need a need in the near future, having that on the radar just to make sure we don't set ourselves up for failure.
I think one more thing that agencies really bring to the table is when you bring everything in-house, you suffer a lot from groupthink. So everyone's just thinking the same thing or just testing the same thing. But we're, you know, you can go to conferences, you can talk to people, but it really comes down to execution and new experimentation, incrementality tests, media mix modeling. So when we bring in agencies, they really bring you know, their internal chops and also exposure to other companies, you know, CPGs, tech companies, things like that. Uber doesn't get exposure to, and, you know, we can really ask ideas and bounce ideas off it. So I think bringing innovation through leveraging agencies is a powerful tool as well.
Yep. So just to kind of round this out, a lot of positives on in-housing and the process that you guys have gone through. How about just the challenges and like, the difficulty in trying to stand up something like this within your organization? How is that process gone for your groups?
Yeah, for us, I mean, it's been and it's been an exciting journey, but there's been some, you know, some not necessarily roadblocks, but some bumps along the way. You know, I would say when we started with the tech migration, for example, you know, you have a vision of timeline, how it's going to go, and those tend to stretch out maybe a little longer than you would hope, but really what I would stress on that front is making sure you have kind of your MVP, what you really need to bite off in year one to make sure that you're ready to support the business, but then have that year two, year three roadmap. So you can always expand, you can always leverage these tools to another level. And then I would say our biggest challenge going back to just the more of the BI or the analyst resources, was making sure we had that dedicated support. The way that we're structured at TaxAct, there's a lot of just ad hoc data requests that come in from whether it's finance or, just other executives. And oftentimes that can trump just some of the data pulls that we want on a daily or weekly basis for optimization. So, making sure that you're really keeping an eye on what gaps you're experiencing in the data workflow and trying to solve for those before it becomes a major issue.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's an issue for me, but definitely getting all the pipes and all the platforms in place took a very long time. So negotiating DCM, getting MediaMath, DBN, DV360, Moat, brand guidelines, things like that. So really getting that all in house in terms of like everybody ramped up, why we're using it, which DMP to use. We tested multiple DMPs, and just getting everybody the knowledge of the whole marketing space up to par. Using an agency, it's relatively turnkey. They're like, hey, we can do your analytics, we can pipe in your data and things like that, but we didn't want to rely on an agency for that. So I think just getting everything up and running, and then after year two and year three, everything was really running like a fine-oiled machine.
Let's give a round of applause to Andrew Patterson and James.